People get bored of me in like 2 minutes, Robert Pattinson told a magazine back in 2009. Considering that he was talking about evading a stalker while filming the movie in Spain, it's a self-deprecating clip that doubles as an example of his absurdist sense of humor. The common denominators to profiles about the 36-year-old actor is that he contains multitudes, and that after spending the first part of his career hounded and stressed out by media, he now likes to play games with interviewers, offering up half-truths in interviews for social media to go crazy over. Pattinson also claims to be a lurker on film Twitter, which if true, means he knows he's developed a reputation for being one of the best and most interesting actors of his generation, in no small part because he keeps choosing to work with talented and unconventional directors like David Cronenberg or Claire Denis. It's not just that Pattinson has technical skills, he's got interesting taste, and as a result, the last decade has seen him give a number of fascinating performances, including a few in movies that the mass audience which embraced Twilight probably wouldn't have otherwise thought about seeing, and maybe didn't see anyway. Pattinson's willingness to look beyond the mainstream for projects is one reason that his body of work is worth following. The other is that when it comes down to it, he's such a unique and mesmerizing screen presence. In this Ringer video essay, we've broken down some of Pattinson's strongest performances to examine what he's brought to an entire cycle of contemporary art house, auteur, and genre cinema. It's easy to make fun of the Twilight movies, and Pattinson's heard all the jokes. He's even probably told them over and over again. But for a series to become a global phenomenon, there's got to be something real at the center of it. And Pattinson's Edward is, at least visually, a magnetic presence, drawing not only the eyes of Kristen Stewart, Smith, and Bella, but an entire generation of viewers, male and female, gay and straight, who bought into the concept of a pale, shimmery, quasi-emo high school vampire boyfriend. What Pattinson is doing in the Twilight movies isn't exactly great acting, but again, it's an example of undeniable presence. And the fact that he was perhaps sublimating his own loathing of the material the whole time might account for that little bit of genuine edge in his scenes, as if he's holding something in. The real upshot of his work in Twilight, of course, is that it made him into a genuine millennial leading man and a bankable star. It also compelled him to find very different kinds of movies to act in as quickly as possible, ones that might rewrite the narrative of his career. He found those projects, but looking back, the charisma was there all along. David Cronenberg has always been a uniquely prescient filmmaker. Back in 1983, his lo-fi sci-fi horror movie Videodrome predicted aspects of an internet culture that was still decades away from coalescing. So it's not a surprise that Cronenberg was the first auteur to see Pattinson's true potential, casting him as a young corporate master of the universe in his Don DeLillo adaptation Cosmopolis, much to the surprise of fans who wondered why an award-winning director who'd worked with Jeremy Irons, Ralph Fiennes, and Viggo Mortensen, among others, was turning to a teenage heartthrob. As for Pattinson's fans, there was no real danger they were going to flock to a willfully obscure, talky intellectual exercise like Cosmopolis, which describes a long day's journey into night in the back of a luxury limousine in New York, with Pattinson's VIP Eric Packer conducting business, getting laid, and being stalked by an unseen assassin, all without ever leaving his car. In performance terms, Pattinson's case is an acting of less is more, and Cronenberg cleverly lets his star's celebrity fill in the movie's blanks. Packer is a symbol of slick millennial callousness. But this kind of minimalism also takes skill on Pattinson's part, and the precise deadpan chill of his acting.
My prostate is asymmetrical.
What does that mean?
I don't know.
Besides being classically Cronenbergian, indicates an intuitive understanding of some very difficult material. Not only does Pattinson hold his own in Cosmopolis, he holds the movie together, letting a cast of A-list international co-stars, including Matthew Almeric and Juliette Binoche, bounce off his stoicism, as DeLillo's parable of sheltered one-percenter arrogance winds towards a grim conclusion. Pattinson would re-team with Cronenberg 2 years later, moving from the backseat to the driver's seat as a limo driver in the Hollywood Gothic Maps to the Stars, a slyly funny supporting performance suggesting a real enduring rapport between director and star. The second best Australian dystopian western of the new millennium, We See You, Mad Max Fury Road, is John Hillcoat's The Rover, which stars Guy Pearce as a former soldier seeking vengeance across a blasted, depopulated outback expanse sometime in the near future. Pearce is a compelling lead, but the movie's soul is provided by Pattinson as Ray, a slow-witted, open-hearted gangbanger who serves as a combination wingman and surrogate son for Pierce's protagonist, a sole and ultimately tragic source of intimacy in a movie defined by violent chance encounters and gory broad daylight ambushes. It's a very old trick when teen movie idols go grungy, and yet Pattinson's close-cropped, emaciated loser doesn't feel like a case of stunt casting. Beyond the plausible U.S. Southern accent,
you don't know exactly where in Carlin we're going, so you've got to take him with you.
And believably feeble body language lies an incisive portrait of neediness, a character whose response to living at the end of the world hasn't been to get tough, but to go soft. In the film's best scene, director David Michaud simply trains the camera on Pattinson as he sits in a car in the dead of night, mumbling along to Carrie Hilson's top 40 hit Pretty Girl Rock, whose strident refrain, could be a joke on the actor's detractors. It plays wonderfully in context, though, as a character grappling with the realization that at this point in his young life, and close to the end of history, there's no return to innocence. He can't go home again, and the loneliness is overwhelming. The story goes that Pattinson sought out the New York-based filmmaking team of Josh and Benny Safdie after seeing a still from their 2014 drama, Heaven Knows What. He just thought it looked like the kind of movie he'd like to make. It's one thing to want to work with edgy independent filmmakers, and another to disappear into their street-level aesthetic. Pattinson's work in Good Time is one of the great movie star disappearing acts of the 21st century. As the endlessly resourceful, yet ultimately naive and self-defeating small-time hood Connie Nikas, Pattinson is like the man who isn't there. It's not just that he's physically unrecognizable beneath a ragged hoodie and bottle blonde dye job. Any trace of leading man magnetism has been erased and replaced with a nervy, feral intensity. He's the kind of guy you'd cross the street at rush hour to avoid. The theme of Good Time is brotherly love, with Connie willing to do anything, including some very bad things, to rescue his incarcerated sibling. And the genius of Pattinson's performance is that he makes you feel and understand the character's impulses unsentimentally. He holds us in a vice without ever trying to bring things in for a hug. Greedy, manipulative, desperate, and doomed, Connie is one of the great 21st century movie anti-heroes and represents the finest work of Pattinson's career so far.
Are you drunk, Mr. Colston? No. You could have fooled me.
Well, I might have had a little.
Says Pattinson's Henry Costin by way of introduction in The Lost City of Zed. The character, who responds to an ad for an aide-de-camp to explorer Percy Fawcett, is a drunk who's trying to turn over a new leaf. He is also, as it turns out, surprisingly capable in high-pressure situations, tougher than he'd look or than he'd readily admit. Henry Costin isn't the hero of James Gray's period piece, and as Pattinson underplays him, he's actually a bit of an enigma. We come to understand why Charlie Hunnam's character Fawcett desires to seek out an ancient buried civilization, to prove himself as a scientist, as a chronicler of humankind. His sidekick's commitment is a bit more mysterious, but it's still very real. And as James Gray's film goes on, we not only grow used to Pattinson's quiet, perceptive presence, but develop a deep, profound attachment to him, a man who has put his belief solely into the belief of another. Costin's steadfast loyalty to Fawcett becomes a state of grace, all which makes his final scene, wherein he tells his lifelong friend that he can't handle one more journey into the rainforest, so affecting.
This search for Zed, I can no longer bear the cost.
There's pragmatism and maybe a bit of self-preservation in this sequence, but also an ineffable sadness, as if Costin knows he's actually not up for anything extraordinary. An acknowledgement of weakness that turns out to be a lifesaver. Few filmmakers in history are as skilled and patient as Claire Denis in observing human behavior, and it's this quality, coupled with a voracious eye for physical beauty that turns her actors into art objects, that made her an ideal collaborator for Pattinson. That and the factor had long been a fan of Denis' striking, oblique cinematic experiments, films like Beau Travail and The Intruder. When originally conceiving her English-language sci-fi thriller High Life, about a spaceship that doubles as a maximum security prison, Denis imagined the lead role for her former collaborator Vincent Gallo, or even for Philip Seymour Hoffman, eccentric veterans with middle-aged bodies and features. But after meeting Pattinson, she realized that despite his youth, he could play an old soul, and told him that he had to be prepared to work in a different way than before. Denis is a hands-on director, and the intimate proximity she has to her actors during shooting is reflected in the beauty of her camera movements, the way the cinematography seems to cling to the performer's skin. Pattinson's character Monte is a study in contrasts, a hardened killer who also becomes a tender caregiver to an infant daughter, who serves as his sole deep space companion towards the end of his journey. In the film's opening scenes, he shares the screen with a baby girl in a way that seems to strip away not only his celebrity and established screen personas, but acting technique altogether. Pattinson is so unselfconsciously focused on his infant co-star that we could be watching a documentary. There isn't a lot of dialogue in High Life, but Pattinson's mannerisms and body language are supremely eloquent anyway. They speak to a continued willingness to push his craft in new directions. It's hard to really judge Pattinson's acting in The Lighthouse because the movie is so deliberately over the top, caught between the elegance of elevated horror and a slapstick silliness that verges daringly on genre parody. In following up his arthouse hit The Witch, director Robert Eggers doubles down on old-school spookiness, cloaking his Mariner's Tale in ghostly black-and-white cinematography. The movie is a double act between Pattinson's itinerant roughneck Ephraim Winslow and the veteran lighthouse keeper Thomas Wake, played by Willem Dafoe, who's taken on the younger man as an apprentice. From the very first scene, Ephraim is suspicious about what the old Wiki is keeping in the lighthouse tower, but he also has secrets of his own, and things start to take on a paranoid, hallucinatory tone, with hints of monsters lurking in the churning New England surf, or maybe just in the minds of the characters. Where Dafoe deliberately hams it up,
"You'll do it! And by God and by golly, you'll do it, smiling lad, cause you like it! You like it cause I says you will!"
Pattinson keeps his man grounded in plausible psychology, at least for a while. Winslow is terse, bitter, and a bit spooked by his surroundings, but trying to power through it all the same. As the movie goes on and reality starts to warp, Pattinson begins stylizing his acting to match Defoe's fever pitch, pushing back against torrents of verbal abuse and unleashing some of his own.
"Sticky laugh, snoring, and your goddamn thoughts! Your goddamn...
At a certain point, the lighthouse and its inhabitants descend into merry, waltzing insanity, and Eggers simply lets his actors rip, with Pattinson gamely holding his own against one of the greatest actors of the era. The predatory fire and brimstone preacher is a southern gothic cliche, and Pattinson tackles it with gusto in The Devil All the Time. According to director Antonio Campos, Pattinson didn't want anyone to hear his backwoods accent until the first day of shooting. And the reedy, high-pitched voice he came up with works perfectly for a character repressing some inner darkness, the sound of a man holding something back.
"Poor soul, we're bringing them chicken livers and that beat-up plate. Well, let's just say I'm inspired to preach on for a minute before we eat. Sure, some of us are better off than others. And I see plenty of white meat and red meat laid out on this table."
Sermonizing over a plate of chicken liver and narcissistically comparing himself to Jesus Christ, Pattinson's pressed in tea garden as a wolf in sheep's clothing, seducing underage members of his flock while hypocritically preaching piety at every turn. For everything that doesn't work about The Devil All the Time, the film gives Pattinson's florid, carefully controlled acting a generous showcase, and suggests villainous depths to be explored at a later date.
"It seems you need an introduction to a prominent Mumbai local on short notice. I'm Neil."
Even if it's hard to understand exactly what Pattinson's character Neil does in Tenet, and how his timeline or timelines intersect with that of the film's protagonist, it's clear on some level he's playing a doppelganger for his director, Christopher Nolan. Like Nolan, Neil is an elegantly coiffed logistics man who gets off on staging elaborate sleight-of-hand set pieces. And since Pattinson doesn't have to carry Tenet's megaton weight on his shoulders, he gives a relaxed, suave, funny supporting performance, drolly doling out exposition.
"In a parallel worlds theory, we can't know the relationship between consciousness and multiple realities. Is your head hurt yet?"
"Yes."
Cutting a persuasive figure in the action sequences. Watch and listen closely, and the slightly sardonic, know-it-all tone of Pattinson's acting sticks out and then makes perfect sense on a second viewing. There's a reason his character seems like he's done this all before, and Pattinson's ability to convey this subtle point with mostly unspoken gestures is crucial. Of all the actors who've played the Caped Crusader since 1989, Pattinson is at once the most media-swarmed and the most mysterious. His stardom occupies a unique niche, somewhere between the A-list and the arthouse margins, and what's interesting about his performance in The Batman is he's rarely seen as Bruce Wayne. And when he is, there's little of the performative charm that has marked other actors' takes on the role, like Val Kilmer or George Clooney. This Batman doesn't compartmentalize between his public and private identities, and he cuts an outsider's figure even when surrounded by power brokers and civilians alike. It's a fascinating take on the part, one which suggests that Batman is Bruce's dominant persona, and that instead of putting on a gravelly crime fighter voice like Christian Bale in the Nolan films, he's simply being himself when he gets behind the cowl.
I'm vengeance.
The question of whether Pattinson will get another crack at the character remains up in the air, but for now, he's offered an intriguing variation on the part. An introverted, antisocial Batman who's as preoccupied with his own psychology as that of the villains around him. We hope that you've enjoyed this Ringer video essay. If you have any thoughts, leave them in the comments, especially if you're Robert Pattinson, who apparently lurks on film Twitter and gets into it with people about his various movies. Let us know what you thought, even if you're not Robert Pattinson. See you next time.